Lives movement raises up the voice of the voiceless and the hope of the hopeless. Our motto is to freely you receive, freely you give. The tagline is, arise and shine, for your light has come, and the glory of the Lord is risen upon you. Taken from the word of God from Isaiah chapter 60, verse 1. Our vision is to raise a banner of hope, rescue the abused, and rise up as world changers. Deborah Rise Movement works under four functions. So they're called the Connects. The Lifeline Connect, the Helpline Connect, the Prayer Connect, and Social Wing Connect. Let me run through each of these. The Lifeline Connect is a common forum for both men and women. This is where we deal with life's challenges that are less spoken of in other forums. So this group is open up for irrespective of religion, caste, and region. Coming to the Helpline Connect, this is a team of prayer warriors who are DRM women. We will receive the helpline calls in the helpline number 8801858585. And anyone who needs this counseling and prayer support, welcome to call this number. And this is open both to men and women. Prayer Connect, the third connect is Prayer Connect. This is for prayer and for healing and deliverance, irrespective of religion. And it happens every Tuesday between 9 p.m. and 10 p.m. And it's open to all men and women. Coming to the Social Win Connect, it is a call to reach out to the homeless and the needy with provisions to support with the support from team from DRM, men and women. So this is about DRM. With no delay, let me introduce the speaker of today, who is Sister Evangeline. She has been training counselors based out of the Bible. She is an MPhil in psychology, and she will be talking to you about a most important topic. Before that, let's bow our heads and look to God in prayer. I request Sister Joanna to lead us in prayer.
Let's pray. Father God, thank you for this wonderful evening, and thank you for bringing all these wonderful women of God together in your name, and for sharing your heart with us, for the abused and for the broken that we come across in this world. Help us, Lord, to carry your love and your light to the people whom you put in our
world.
In 1 hour, Lord, even as we listen to one another and even as we learn from one another, we pray that you will overshadow us with your presence. We may be connecting from different places, but wherever we are, Lord, we pray that your presence will be with us, and we pray that you will teach each one of us personally, Lord. And we ask you, Lord, to take us through this 1 hour with your grace, and let your presence be with us the whole time. And let this time be a time of great blessing for all of us. In the name of Jesus, we pray.
Thank you, Sister Joanna.
Welcome.
The topic for today is psychotherapy techniques for the addicts and the depressed. So let's move into the talk. Welcome, Evangeline Akka, and the floor is open to you.
Thank you very much for this invitation. It's such a joy. Yes. Thank you very much for inviting me. It's such a joy to be part of the Deborah Rise Movement. And I've always felt there is a beautiful verse which applies to this program of Deborah Rise. Who can despise the day of small beginnings? When we started, it was a very, very small seed. But now it has grown into a banyan tree, which gives so much comfort, so much solace, and so much joy to so many people. So thank you so much for having me here. And it's such a joy and an honor to be a part of this entire program. So this evening, we've been talking a series. We've been studying on addicts. We've been studying on people who have depression as a problem. We've tried to understand the causes. we've tried to understand the etiology of what actually causes depression and what actually causes addiction. So we have tried to understand these people. So when we try to do this, we are also going to talk about how we need to counsel these people, how we need to understand these people. So when we try to counsel these people, there are some counseling skills which are very, very appropriate, which are fashioned to counsel addicts and the depressed souls. So this evening, as we are going to talk about how we need to empathetically counsel, sensitively counsel, delicately handle the feelings, emotions, and background of these addicts and the depressed, we need to understand the personality of the counselor makes a huge difference. The personality of the counselor has to be one which will draw people towards them, especially the broken, especially the addicts and the depressed. So when we begin what we are going to talk about this evening, I think in counseling skills, one very, very important aspect that we need to remember is the aspect of confidentiality. When people come and share their hearts to us, when they open our hearts, their hearts to us, even in the cloak of prayer, even under the guise of prayer, we do not have permission. We do not have the right to talk about somebody's problem or somebody's information to somebody. We can generally tell them, I am counseling somebody, you can pray for them. But we cannot go into details and we cannot share private details of somebody. Maintaining confidentiality is a very, very important counseling skill that we need to remember. And that is something which will build trust with the addict and the depressed, because they're going to share a lot of sensitive issues, issues that are going to show what they've gone through. It may be abuse, it can maybe a broken home, it may be something which is very, very embarrassing for them. When they open up their hearts to us, I think it is important that we keep it to ourselves. So we need to give them the trust that whatever they share will remain in the room. Whatever they share will remain with the counselor. Confidentiality is very important. But even before this, there is something called a rapport. We need to build a rapport. We cannot start counseling, start advising straight away. We need to build a rapport, which means we need to make the person comfortable in talking to us. Give them a lot of hope. Give them a lot of assurance. Give them a lot of love. Give them a lot of unconditional love, respect, and acceptance. They need to understand through the relationship that we offer them that they can trust us. And we also have to instill a lot of hope during the rapport building process. When we say hope, we have to tell them, see, this is not the end of your life. You can definitely come out of this problem. You can walk out of addiction. You can walk out of depression gracefully with the help of the Lord. So we need to build rapport. And during this process, there are two or three things that happen. We need to promise confidentiality. We need to promise trust. And they have to be able to trust us with all their delicate details. And we also need to instill hope in their hearts. Now, when we do this, we also have to develop in us a skill called listening. Listening is something which is very important. Even if we are counsel people who do not have very major problems, when you really give a listening and an empathetic ear to people, they feel so good. When we listen, we don't listen only to the words, but we also listen to the feelings and the emotions of the person. Sometimes they say certain things. Most of the times they don't say certain things. So we listen to what they say. We also listen to what they do not say. And we also listen to their feelings. We listen to their hurt. We listen to their anger. Sometimes these may not come out verbally, but non-verbally we can understand it through the tone that they communicate to us. And that is very important. And when it comes to the personality of the counselor, try to be genuine, try to be warm, try to be compassionate. try to be as soft-spoken as possible. And we need to reflect the Spirit of the Lord, the fruits of the Spirit here, when we develop the personality of the counselor. When we talk about this, I also want to mention the problem of burnout in counselors, especially when they deal with addicts and the depressed, because this is not a one-time counseling session when we counsel addicts and we counsel the depressed. This is a long-term sessions. This will take at least a year. Or for some people, it will take more than a year. For some people, it will take just about half a dozen sessions. It is going to be different for every client, for every person. So it is very important that we keep ourselves afresh. We need to keep re-energizing ourselves. We should not be taking all these sensitive issues to the bed with us so that we are not emotionally drained. So when we listen to some heavy stuff like rape and abuse and addictions, which have been really strong, when we listen to that, I think we need to hand it over to the Lord and tell them, so Lord, these are the burdens that have been communicated to me. Lord, help me not to carry it with me. Help me to place all these burdens at your feet so that you will be sovereign over it. So that is what will keep us from getting burnt out. And the counselor also has to have periodical breaks and periodical vacations. Now, when we talk about the counselor skills, we also have to remember something called a sexuality. The counselor has to be very, very careful when he counsels the opposite sex, whether it is a she or a he. I would advise that it is always safe for you to have a co-counselor with you or the family member of the client with you, because it is not safe to counsel the opposite sex, because they may be sharing some sensitive issues, maybe family issues, maybe problems concerning their sexual issues in their marriage, which is an unfulfilled need. These are all issues that we cannot take risks and listen to them, especially when we belong to the opposite sex. So the sexuality of the counselor has to be protected, and that is very important. Now, when we talk about prayer in the counseling session, there are some non-Christians also who come to us, but they feel prayer has a lot of power. Prayer has a lot of energy to give us a lot of strength. It gives the person inner strength. It energizes the person. It helps the person to understand that in prayer we communicate to God. But I think it is always wise and always sensible and always safe to ask the client, can we pray for you? Would you like to start the session with a prayer? Would you like all the issues that we have discussed, can we hand it over to the Lord in prayer? If they are comfortable with that, we can always pray. But if they say, no, I do not want to be prayed for, then they can be, you know, that feeling also can be respected. So that is one area where we need to remember. Now, counseling is a trialogue. It is not a dialogue. It doesn't happen between two people. It is a trialogue where the counselor speaks to the counselee, the counselee speaks to the counselor, and the third person is the Holy Spirit. The counselor keeps talking to the Holy Spirit, keep listening to the Holy Spirit. Lord, I do not understand what this person is telling me. I don't know how to answer this person. I don't know what to do in this juncture. Lord, give me your wisdom. Lord, give me your understanding. Help me to sensitively empathize with this person. So there is a constant trialogue that happens between the counselor, the counselee, and the Holy Spirit. That is one thing we need to remember. Now, with this background, I would also like to remind you all that the mantle that is before us, the commission that is before us, is in Isaiah chapter 61. The verse says, the chapter is a beautiful chapter. I think it is written for people who are in the healing ministry, who are in the counseling ministry. It says, the Lord has anointed me. The Spirit of the Lord is upon me to heal the brokenhearted, to deliver prisoners, to keep prisoners, to bring out people from captivity, to bring out people from mourning. Now, all these things are presented in this chapter. When you have time, please talk about it. It talks about comfort. It talks about deliverance. It talks about joy. It talks about turning mourning into dancing. Ultimately, the counselor is called Oaks of Righteousness because we are in the healing ministry. Now, with this background, I would like to tell you how we need to counsel addicts and how we need to counsel the depressed people. And when we talk about counseling the addicts, it's actually two-sided. One is people who are addicted to substances, and the other part of it is people who are addicted to addictive behaviors. Okay, so many times we come to an understanding. It is very difficult to counsel these people. It is absolutely impossible to bring out an addict. Now, we should also remember, as I told you, that this counseling the addicts and the depressed is a process. There are also miracles that happen. Now, I have gone to a camp. I have this experience. So I think I should tell you to encourage this. I went to a camp and there was an uncle who was constantly smoking in the camp. He was an addict and he was continuously smoking. And believe me, this was a Christian camp. But then he said, after he went through all the sessions in the camp, when he got into the bus, when he left the camp, he threw his last cigarette. That was the last time he had a smoke. So God can touch people like that. And miracles can happen. But it doesn't happen all the time because God has his own ways of using people in the lives of addicts and in the lives of depressed people. God uses counselors. Now, when we talk about counseling substance abusers, there's something we need to remember. We cannot give up. They've been addicts for a long time. This habit has taken so many years to develop. How can I break it? It's going to definitely take a long time because habits take a long time to develop. So it is going to take a long time to break those habits also. There are a few things we need to remember here. The first thing is when you counsel a person, counsel the addicts, there is something called commitment building. Commitment building. We need to build a commitment. The person has to admit. The addict has to admit, yes, I have a problem. Yes, I have a problem with alcohol. I have a problem with marijuana. I have a problem with cocaine. That admittance has to come. If the person is going to be in denial and say, no, I don't drink that often. No, it's only a social behavior. No, it happens only occasionally. No, I am not a drinker at all. I can stop it whenever I want. If that kind of a denial is going on, then our counseling is not going to be very, very helpful in the long run. So during this commitment building phase, the person has to be challenged of denial. The person has to be helped to admit that there is a problem, and they also have to understand that we need the support of others to come out of this problem. So they have to learn to depend on God completely, and they also have to learn to examine themselves. That is very important. Now, when we talk about denial, not just the counselee, not just the addict, but the family also is in denial sometimes. Sometimes they feel, no, my son doesn't drink that much, you know, only during Christmas and New Year, only occasionally on birthday parties. So they have that kind of an attitude because they want to protect their children. They want to protect the addict, which is not going to be healthy at all. We have to face the problem. We have to help the family and the client to understand that this is a problem that has to be admitted as a problem. So let the family not cover the alcoholic or cover the addict of any substance abuse or as a behavioral addiction. And then we need to understand that they have to agree as a family to cooperate with the treatment. It can be a therapy, it can be psychotherapy, or it can be counseling. Now, the topic of this program is psychotherapy skills. Psychotherapy means intensive counseling. It is a psychological word, but then we also have secular psychotherapy and Christian psychotherapy. Christian psychotherapy has all its principles rooted in the Word of God, and a lot of psychology which goes in harmony with God's word. Whatever psychology does not go in harmony with the God, with God's word, it goes out of the window. Okay, now when we talk about getting the addict to accept the problem, these addicts also come with problems totally unrelated to alcohol, totally unrelated to any addiction. So that is one thing we need to remember. Okay, it can be a family issue. It can be their inability to resolve stress. It can be a marital issue. It can be an issue with their low self-esteem. It can be a work spot stress. It can be anything. So it can be a problem which is not related to alcohol at all. So the counselor has to be ready to help the person when they come in with all these issues. And we have to show them specific examples of, see, when you are not able to admit that you have a problem, look at all the damage that you have caused. There has been debt in the family. All these articles in your house has been broken. So we have to show them this is the damage you and your family are going through when you have this problem of addiction. You have a low self-esteem. So these are some things which we have to very, very carefully and sensitively teach the person. The second aspect that we need to remember after the stage of rapport building is something called motivation. The first thing is commitment building. The second thing is motivation. Now, I talk about motivation because initially these people and the family are very motivated because they feel like, if you feel that I can come out of this problem, if somebody can assure me that I can come out of this problem, if somebody can assure a lot of support, I want to do it. They will be motivated initially. But when there is something called a relapse, when they fail, when they are not able to keep up to their word, when they look at friends and they fall into temptation again and have a substance again or have a peg again, then they become demotivated. That is the time the counselor comes in. So you have to keep up the motivation of the person to stay with the rehabilitation, to stay with the counseling, to stay with the psychotherapy, and also during times of relapses. Now, this motivation can come through lot of positive vibes. Give them lot of positive feedback. See, you have been dry for one day. You have not gone into the pornographic site for one day. And that is very good. It may be a very, very minimal change. It may be a very minimal or a small change towards the positive road. But then please give them a lot of feedback and positive reassurance during this time. And when you give them this kind of a motivation, assure them of something called prayer and concern. Tell them, we are praying for you. We are supporting you emotionally. Every time you feel low, every time you feel down, we are all here to support you and we are concerned about you. So these are all some fallback pillows that we give the counselor. And we also have to show them, when you do not stay motivated, this is the impact that happens to your body, to your physiology, and also to your family. Now, there is one thing we need to remember. When we motivate, we should never instill guilt. You have gone wrong. You have fallen. See, you promised me that you will not go back into the addiction, but you have done it. How can you do that? So any amount of guilt is going to demotivate them further. So let us not make them feel guilty, because the Lord does not make them feel guilty. He is continuing to give them support, show them concern. And what he has done on the cross for the addicts and for the depressed remains. And that has not changed at all. And one other thing we need to remember when we talk about motivation, help the family also to cope with the relapses, because they can really get discouraged. So we need to tell them, even in the beginning, there will be a relapse. There may be many relapses. There may be multiple relapses. Don't give up. Don't worry. It's okay. We are all going to go through this together. But then when we want to avoid relapses, it is very important that we help and alert the family and the client to avoid high risk situations, to avoid such friends, to avoid such places which may tempt them, and also teach them better coping skills, which I will talk about a little more in the future in this talk, and also talk about overconfidence. I've started psychotherapy. I've gone into 10 sessions of counseling. I am never going to drink again. I am never going back to that site again. It cannot be like that. So be aware of overconfidence also, because once the drug has been ingested into the body, once any kind of euphoria has happened in the body or any kind of chemical addiction is there in the body, it is there in the brain also. So the brain starts craving. The brain starts asking for more and more. So this craving can cause a lot of withdrawal. That is very important. So during this motivation time, we also have to give them a lot of assurance about the support system that is available for them. The third aspect we need to remember is something called acceptance. It is acceptance, unconditional acceptance of the person and not the behavior. We love you. We don't love your behavior. We accept you. We don't accept your behavior. We respect you. We are not able to respect certain words you use during your loss of judgment. It is very, very important that you offer sustained and supportive relationship during this time. Acceptance is very important. And also tell the person that during this time of acceptance, of when you go through loneliness, when you go through a time when you feel there is nobody to stand with me, this is a very, very strong temptation. I am not able to face this. I am not able to stand this. I am not able to cope with this kind of a stress. Tell them they are not alone. Tell them that you are there for them. The family is giving them ultimate support. So we need to also counsel the family and counsel the client. Always involve the family in your counseling. That is very, very important. And there is also something called Alcoholics Anonymous. There is also something called Substance Anonymous. There are also groups which are called support systems which help with addictive behaviors also. The only thing about this group is all of them have to be members there only if they are alcoholics or only if they are addicted to any kind of an addictive behavior. That is the only qualification that they require there. So when that happens, everybody in the group shares their story. It's going to be a delicate, sensitive, tearful time sometimes. They all open up their hearts. They talk about their childhood. They talk about embarrassing times. They talk about painful times. They talk about hurts. They talk about past abuse. They talk about all that. But then they know that they are accepted in the group with all their limitations. That is very important. And the next thing is we need to remember is stop the drinking. Stop the drinking. Help them to stop the drinking. Help them to have total abstinence is one kind of a theory. The other kind of the theory is slowly wean. For example, if the person has been having about 10 packs a day of cigarettes, then you can slowly encourage the person to make it 9, to make it 8, and make it 7, and make it 5. It can be. It can. There are actually two theories here. But then it's important that at this stage, you tell significant others about the addiction and about how the addict is taking positive efforts to come out of this problem. The family has to be made alert. The pastor and the friends and people who are having a positive input into this person's life. So having regular contact with recovering alcoholics, with people who are recovering, will also really help this person. The other important thing when we counsel addicts is that these addicts usually are lonely. We talked about this when we talked about the etiology. We talked about family causes. We talked about physiological causes. We talked about stress management. So when we talk about stress management here, please do counsel them on how to handle stress and how to cope with certain things that they do not know how to cope. Like, for example, when there is too much stress at home, talk to them and tell them, help them to verbally express what are all the kind of stressors that you have. Which do you think is the most stressing issue for you? See, sometimes these people feel everything is overwhelming. Everything is too much for me. I cannot put up with this anymore. But then when you help them to make a hierarchy, that is something called a hierarchy, which means you help them to keep a journey and you help them to understand that, ask them to write what is the most pressurizing issue. So you must, they start writing one by one and then they start prioritizing which is the most pressurizing stressor, and then they slowly start working with you one by one. They cannot become angels overnight. They cannot stop becoming addicts overnight. It's going to take a long time, but they will start working on that one by one. Now, when we talk about stress management, teach them how to handle stress. Teach them clear planning. Teach them to talk about stress. Teach them to talk about what is actually causing them the stress. Sometimes they don't know. Sometimes they feel very vague. Sometimes they feel very confused. So that is why this writing down will actually help them. So when they write down and they talk to you, say, I'm not able to do this because of this reason. When they say that, then you can start working from there. That also really helps. Actually giving them a safe place to ventilate, that also helps them to manage with the stress. Okay. And the next aspect is encourage self-understanding. They feel encouraged self-understanding. They feel, I am not able to understand myself. I know I should not be angry. I know this is a very petty issue. I know I should not be talking like this. I know I should not do this. But I don't know why I am doing this. So help them to understand themselves. See, I had a client some time ago, a patient. She was telling me, Auntie, I absolutely have no friends, Auntie. I don't know why people go away from me. Nobody stays with me. I'm not able to maintain a relationship. I don't understand myself. So we sat and talked about it at length, at leisure. And then I slowly showed her that some of her behaviors and some of the words she uses in her communication that actually irritates people, and that does not help her to maintain good and healthy relationships. So when she understood that, she started refraining from using foul language. She changed her tone. She changed the way she communicated to people. And now today, she's a person who makes a lot of healthy relationships. So this is actually a process towards healing. So we need to understand ourselves. Addicts need to understand their behavior. Addicts need to understand why they do what they do. And the other important thing is they have to have a change in their lifestyle. We'll talk about that a little more. And when we talk about self-understanding, we also have to talk about maybe there are some insecurities in their lives. What is the security that they have? What is making them insecure? Are they holding on to the right kind of security? Sometimes they feel this is my security, but it may have a very temporary value. So we have to tell them that these are all issues that can keep changing. These are all not permanent issues. That is why you feel very insecure. So we have to show them what is real security. We have to show them that security in Christ alone is going to last. That is going to be the only permanent thing. Your security in your money, or the way you feel good about your addiction, or your family, or the car you have, or the house you have, or the bank balance you have. This is not security, because all these have a very temporary value. And then they may have developed some fears from their childhood, which has pushed them into this addiction. It can be a possible childhood abuse, which they're not able to handle. They're not able to talk about that abuse to anybody. They're not able to forgive themselves. They are not able to forgive the person who abused them. Sometimes they are even harboring a lot of anger towards God. Lord, why didn't you protect me from this abuse? When you have let me down, I don't know where else to go for comfort. So they go to any kind of an addiction for comfort. So we need to help them to elicit the root causes for the addiction and slowly try to help them vent all these stresses. Once they have an insight into the problem, once they have an insight into the stress, then we will work out some realistic plans of how we can really help them to come out. The next aspect is counsel the family. Counsel the family. I've been talking about this. I've been only mentioning. Counsel the family. Talk to them. Ask them to spend a lot of time with the addict. Ask them to sit with the addict. Laugh with them. Joke with them. Have lighter moments in life with them. And not just that, when the client wants to talk to the family member, sometimes the family member also can have points of frustration. They can be irritable. Sometimes they have something called a threshold. I cannot put up with this man anymore. I cannot put up with this behavior anymore. I cannot put up with this kind of a addictive behavior in my house anymore. Sometimes we have a threshold like that. But then it is very important that we encourage the family to be a little more patient, to ask the Lord for patience, to help the client to come out of it. Sometimes they keep talking about it. They have a need to talk about it. Please help the family to just quietly sit and listen to them. They don't have to counsel them at all. All they have to do is just give them an empathetic listening ear. That is very, very important. And the other thing is we need to understand this. Alcoholism is also a family problem. It starts with family issues. So if it is going to have a marital cause or a problem with children or it's a problem with finance, any kind of an addiction, we need to counsel the family. And we also need to understand that we need to recognize and understand the spiritual dimension addiction has. Ultimately, we have to direct this person to God. Now, there are two goals in counseling. One is evangelism and the other is definitely discipleship. These two are the hidden agendas of counseling. Very, very gently, we have to tell them, see, we have tried all these methods. We have tried all this, but it's not working. Shall we try God? Shall we try God? God will help you to break yourself free from this kind of a addiction. That is one thing we need to remember. Okay, now we've talked a little bit about addiction of substance abuse. So I'll just go through that again. Motivation is very important. Acceptance is important. Commitment building. Support. Getting the addict to admit the problem, challenge the denial, stop the drinking, help the person to get a lot of support, help the person to manage stress and teach them coping skills and encourage self-understanding and to change their lifestyles, counsel the family and help the family also to cope with the relapses and recognize that there is a spiritual dimension to our addictive behaviors. Now, as we come a little closer to this, I think it is also important that when we talk to addicts about relapses and denial and stopping the drinking, there is a very important principle in counseling. The principle is when you want to remove something, we have to replace that with something alternative, which is more healthy, which is more stimulating or equally stimulating. Because when we remove something, we cannot leave a vacuum or an empty space here. So we need to give the addict a clear schedule. Let the schedule and the goal not be the counselors, but let it be the schedule which has been worked out with the client, with the addict. Both of you, the client and the counselor, can sit together. Would you like to do this in the morning? Would you like to do this after that? So get a waking up time, brushing teeth, eating, making your own breakfast, washing your clothes, doing this, doing that. Make a schedule which will keep the client occupied and purposeful, which will keep the client, make the people, client happy so that their self-esteem also will be enhanced. That is very important. Okay. Now, let's move on a little bit into how we counsel behavioral addictions. There is gambling. There is shopping. Procrastination is also a behavioral addiction. Codependency, workaholism, religious addiction, sometimes continuous failures at self-control. That also can be a problem. I tried not to do this. I tried not to become, but it becomes compulsive. So I have some behaviors which are very compulsive in me. Now, some of these behavioral addictions, they also have a physical basis, which may require medical treatment, during when you have to guide them to a professional counselor, or you guide them to a medical psychiatrist who will find out if there is a chemical craving, if there is a chemical addiction that is going on psychologically, socially, and physiologically in the body. Now, we're talking a little bit about porn watching and screen addiction. Now, this is happening not just with adults, but is starting very, very early. A couple of days ago, I had a person who spoke to me. He was a very, very important person in the government. Now, this person calls and says, there is a 6-year-old boy who is addicted to the screen, who has an addiction towards pornography. Now, this really shook me. This boy is 6 years old and he is addicted to the screen and addicted to pornography, not just Dora and Tom and Jerry. Now, where is the problem? What is the problem? The counselor has to understand by sitting and talking with the little boy and with the family for us to understand, because it can be different reasons for different people. We cannot judge and immediately say maybe the parents didn't spend time with the child. That's why the child has gone into this kind of addiction. That will be too quick a judgment. I think we need to be really alert not to do that. Okay, so when we talk about porn watching, it can be for children, it can be for adolescents, it can be for adults, it can be for women also. Now, when we talk about this, we need to understand why people get into porn addiction. That is something we need to definitely understand as counselors. Now, these people who are pornography addicts, they are usually unable or unwilling to establish intimate and healthy non-sexual relationships with the opposite sex. I hope you understand this. If they are not able to maintain healthy non-sexual relationships with the opposite sex, then that becomes a problem. Sometimes they have been hurt in the past. Sometimes they've been hurt in the past by the opposite sex, or they are afraid of the opposite sex and they have built a wall around themselves. Sometimes they fear the ability of performing sexually. Maybe the other person will tease me. Maybe the other person will bully me. They have that kind of a conflict within themselves, or they have a very poor confidence in them that they may not be able to perform sexually properly. So they satisfy themselves by watching pornography and a lot of fantasies. Sometimes the same kind of a sexual activities can also lead into a boredom. They want a novelty, so they start watching porn, sexual activities. Sometimes they require something called a mental erotica or a mental stimulation. So some need there is being unmet. So as counselors, when you counsel people with behavioral addiction, be very, very sensitive. Listen very carefully to what is not being said. Listen very carefully to pick out which need is not being met. Once you find that out, then I think you have to very gently tell the counselee, how do you feel this need is being met? I feel you feel empty in this place. Do you feel the same way? Can you explain a little more? Can you talk about it a little more? How do you feel about this? When we open the way like that, when we give them space and freedom and confidentiality and a safe place for them to open up their hearts, they will come out with what is not being met there. Now, these people, when we help them out, help them especially with porn watching, there are two very, very important but very difficult solutions. One is help them to communicate. Help them to encourage communication. Talking is very important, because these people are not able to cultivate healthy relationships. So encourage communication and close contact with healthy people, with people, and have them as good peer group, or have them as healthy friends. Because as people start becoming more addicted to porn, when it becomes more are frequent, they slowly start withdrawing themselves more and more from others, and they start isolating themselves because nobody knows about their problem. Nobody knows what they are going through on the inside. So they start fantasizing, and that grows out of restrictions. And then there's an erotica in the mind. They start getting addicted to that erotica. It becomes mental adultery. So communication and close contact has to be replaced by fantasy. That is very important. Now, the act of will, I want to come out of this porn addiction, that alone is not sufficient. We have to replace it with healthy communication and healthy development and healthy making of relationship. Now, when we talk about behavioral addiction, there is a concept of habituation, which is something we need to remember, which we need to understand. Now, habituation means it is a situation where a stimulus creates a response. Now, people who have all studied basic science will know when there is a stimulus, then there is also always a response. Now, as you are listening to me, why don't you pinch yourself and see? Give yourself a little pain, a little hard pinch. Can you do that? When you pinch, there is a startle. You remove your hand because you don't want that pain. That is a reflex. So every stimulus will definitely give a response. Now, a loud noise will give a startle response to a dog or people or anybody or a baby. Now, when this loud noise is presented repeatedly, then your mind tells you, oh, there's going to be a loud noise now. There's going to be a loud noise now. So the mind starts anticipating, and then that will not create any more responses because you know there is going to be a loud noise. Just like that, try applying this to the abuse of the drug, or try applying this to an addictive behavior. It can be masturbation, it can be sex, it can be pornography, it can be shopping, it can be screen addiction, it can be anything. Okay, it can be gambling, it can be anything. The first exposure will create a very high euphoria. Okay, then to say get the same euphoria, to get the same stimulating effect, more and more images have to be seen. More and more drugs have to be ingested so that something called an equilibrium is maintained. These are all some words we need to keep in the back of our mind and understand. When a person wants to have the same amount of stimulation, they have to have more and more of such images, more and more of such drugs that have to be ingested into the body. Now, when this happens, there is also a process of conditioning that happens. Now, what is this conditioning? Even a mere thought of the drug, or a mere thought of that behavior, or a mere thought of a pornographic image, that can create a high biological craving in the brain, in the person. I hope you understand this. I will repeat it for you. A mere thought of the image, or a mere thought of any pornographic activity, or a mere thought of a drug, that itself can create a biological craving. That can be the same with behavioral addictions also. So the image which created an erotica about a month ago will not create the same amount of erotica now. So I need something more erotic to see so that I will maintain that equilibrium to maintain the same kind of a stimulation. So the more and more is craved for. This is what is called conditioning. So this habituation and this conditioning can be reduced only if the person can be weaned away of the substance or the behavior. This is very important. Now, when we do this, with this understanding, when we have to do this, what do we do? There are four things that we need to do quickly. One is determination. I want to change. This is not a one-time decision. It has to be a repeated decision. It has to be a daily decision, because even in behavioral addictions, relapses is common. So the counselor is obliged to keep encouraging them, not instilling guilt again, and being accountable to the counselor. Today I did not go near the screen. Today I did not do this. Today I did not masturbate. Today I did not look at pornographic images. So be accountable to the counselor. That is something you need to teach them. The other thing in addictive behaviors is something called replacement. Now there are two techniques here. One is thought stopping. Every time you crave for a pornographic image, every time you crave for a behavioral addiction, then that is the time when you have to stop the thought. And the other thing, stop the thought and replace it with something else. And thought switching is the second concept. I don't want this kind of a thought to be happening in me, because if I encourage that thought, then that is going to lead to behavior. So I will not encourage this thought, but I will switch my thought to something else. When I want to think about masturbation, I will think about something else. I will go to the kitchen and start cooking, or I will keep my fingers in a more purposeful activity. Okay, so that is the kind of a thought switching. Success rehearsal is another thing we need to remember. Success rehearsal means, yesterday I was able to keep away from pornographic images. Wow, good for me, call us up. So I was able to do that yesterday. Today also I will be able to do that. So keep rehearsing success in your mind. Yesterday the Lord helped me to say no to that phone call from a friend. Today also I will be able to do that. So the Lord is helping me to be a little more assertive and helping me, strengthening me in saying no. Because the Bible says, get rid of sinfulness, get rid of lust, get rid of shameful desires, get rid of purity. So when we want to get rid of impurity and all this, we have to replace it with something healthy and better and good. This is what Paul keeps telling us. Replace your mind with things that are true, lovely, noble, and things that are going to last for a long time. Only that is going to remain. Keep renewing your mind. That is what is very important. Remove lustful thoughts, but then you replace those lustful thoughts with something. Now, none of this is going to work if the addict is going to stay with that stimulus, which we talked about earlier. Maybe friends who talk about this, maybe pictures which are around in his room, or maybe those kind of songs which stimulates him into that kind of a behavior. So any kind of a stimulating activity towards an addictive behavior has to be removed. Oh, okay, I'll give you one example now. Now, pornographic addicts have to keep away from any kind of porn-inducing, porn-reminding materials. They have to keep away from casinos. And a practical example I'll tell you. Now, porn addicts are addicted to the computer, to the screen, that we know. Now, instead of keeping the computer away from them, keeping the computer in a place where the entire family can see will be a better solution. That is a more practical solution. Okay, so don't allow a vacuum in this concept of replacement, because we know in the Bible we see when the Lord chased away one devil, when the place was empty, when the disciples chased away one devil, the legion came back and said that saw that the place was empty and he brought back seven. Okay, that may be a problem. So I think we should not leave it empty. When we remove a behavior, we have to replace it with a healthy behavior. When somebody comes to Christ, all things pass away. The verse does not stop there. It says all things pass away, all things become new. So God brings in new things there. The third aspect we need to remember here is need fulfillment. Identify the unfulfilled need, need fulfillment. That there are two needs here. One is, I'll give you two examples. It can be a need for security. It can be a need for significance. It can be a need for a healthy self-esteem. It can be a need for respect. It can be a need for love. It can be a need for anything. Okay, once we know that there is a need which is not being met, I'll give you one example. A person who is very compulsive to TV watching. Now this person, this mother brings a child to you and says, my child is continuously watching the TV. I am not able to stop the child from watching TV. This becomes an addiction. Okay, when the parent is calling it an addiction, and we go back to the definition of addiction, if it is falling into the definition of addiction, then we understand this example in context. Okay, a person who is compulsively watching TV or any screen, it shows us that this person is desperately in need of human contact. But this person has a fear of intimacy, fear of having interpersonal skills, lacking interpersonal skills. This is a very obvious thing that we need to understand as counselors. So we need to tell them, tell the family, tell the parents to bring in friends into the house, to bring in peer groups into the house, to introduce games into the house, carom board, shuttle, Chinese checkers, ludos, any healthy games that the child can play, which will very gently help the person to form healthy relationships and interpersonal skills with the other people. And the struggler will be able to relate well and slowly wean himself from the compulsive watching of TV. Another example I'll tell you. Maybe there is a person who is compulsively eating. Okay? Binging or gluttony is his problem. Now, they may be continuously snacking because they don't know how to handle stress. They don't know how to handle anxiety. They don't know how to handle boredom. This may be a problem. Now, this person can be taught more healthy ways of handling stress. Talk about it, go to a shuttle court and play, talk to your friend, or go with your friends for a walk, go for an ice cream, read a book, bring out your potentials. These are all ways of showing yourself that there is a lot of potentials and skills inside which are dying because it is not being used. So it is the counselor's responsibility to tap all these potentials and show them that these are all stress relieving issues and this is how you handle your stress. Talk about your stress, plan to handle your stress, learn to cope with your stress, and take occasional breaks from situations that may cause you stress. And the fourth thing is lifestyle management for people who are struggling with behavioral addictions. How do we start that? This is a starting point for healing. Now, we talk about all these principles, but lifestyle also has to change. What they eat, when they relax, when they sleep, how much of exercise do they have? How much do they slow down their body? See, sometimes people have a need for achievement. People want to achieve. People want to show people, this is my worth. I want to prove to my team that this is what I was able to achieve and complete. We do not have to do that because when we do that, there is a lot of stress and tension and excess adrenaline being produced in the body, which causes a lot of stress. So we need to teach them to burn that excess amount of adrenaline, develop new habits, and remove all the tempting environments, reset your priorities. And the most important stress-producing thing in our culture is learning to please others. What will others think of me? What will others think if I don't do this? What will others think if I do this? If I wear this dress, what will others think of me? This itself produces a lot of stress. So we have to unlearn this concept of why should I try to please others? It is important to please others in certain areas, but I cannot please everyone. I cannot make everybody happy. I cannot control the feelings of others. I cannot try to understand everything. I cannot try to control my situation. These are all areas where we need to help people to understand this is what produces stress in your body, helps addicts to relax. But this cannot happen in a month or so. It cannot happen hurriedly. It can happen only very, very slowly. This is something we need to really remember when we talk about addicts and self-addictive behaviors. Okay, now with this background, with this understanding, if you have any more doubts, if you have any more questions, you can always ask me. Now, this is about addiction. When we talk about depression, most of the addicts have depression as a problem. Now, how do you counsel depression as a problem? How do you confront it? How do you understand? We use the same counseling skills, use a lot of empathy, build confidentiality, build trust, build a lot of good rapport with the person who is depressed, because more than the addicts, the person who is depressed with addiction is going to be really withdrawn because they have been hurt in the past. Somebody tried to help me, but whatever I shared with them, they went and told somebody, and that person told somebody, and it has gone as a story outside. I am not going to trust anybody. So I build a wall around myself. I am not going to trust anyone. Usually people who are depressed, people who are addicts, take a long time to open up. So this rapport building stage is very, very important. So depression can be handled pharmacologically, which means with medicines, and it can also be handled non-pharmacologically. Why do we talk about pharmacological and medical treatment? Because it also has a physiological and a biological basis. B12 deficiencies, thyroid, glandular problems, brain tumors, some kind of a vitamin issues, and adrenaline issues, brain chemicals which are imbalanced. All these can also cause depression, which we have already talked about in the previous episodes. If you do feel you cannot understand all this, please go into the Deborah Rice Moment YouTube, subscribe yourself, and look at all our YouTube series so that you will have a series of study about this. Okay, now as we are counseling people who are depressed, we need to be extremely sensitive. The first thing we need to do is reach out to them verbally. Reach out to them verbally. Sometimes touch also helps. Non-verbal reaching out also helps, but reach out to them verbally, giving them a lot of optimistic, positive reassurance. We read in the book of Proverbs chapter 12 that a good word, a strong word, a healthy word, a positive word helps the person. It builds the person. It makes the face of the person light up. Okay, so use a lot of optimistic, reassuring statements. Give them a lot of compliments. Give them a lot of promises. Give them a lot of promises from the scripture. Tell them that, see, these are all things that you can do to come out of your depression. These are all areas where we can work on. There is a lot of hope in your situation. Excuse me. There is a lot of hope in your situation. But then when we counsel people who are depressed, the counselor usually has a temptation to pull out the person very fast. Don't expect quick action. Don't expect quick change. Don't expect quick healing. Go in the pace of the person. Slow down. As you start counseling the person in two or three sessions, you will understand the speed of the person. You will understand the pace of the person. When that happens, then you can follow that pace and don't expect them to quickly come to your pace because you want to see a quick change. Because that will actually break them, that will bring them to a place where they will get discouraged. And avoid confrontation when you start with, okay? And we've talked quite a lot about listening, and the Bible says, be quick to listen. So listen to their words, listen to negative thinking, see if there is any anger coming out when you are listening to them, see if there is a lot of hurt that is coming out, see if there are any traits of abuse here and there, which they are not saying, see if there is any traits of poor self-esteem, losses, failure, any rejection, any guilt that is coming out. These are all areas where we need to very attentively listen for people to understand, because these depressed people will not be able to verbalize. Many times in my counseling experience, I have seen people just come and quietly sit. Do you want to talk about something? No, I'm okay. Are you all right today? Do you want to say something? No, I don't want to say anything. See, they will be running out of words. There is something called a poverty of vocabulary when we talk about depressed people. So encourage them. Start a general topic. Talk about clothes. Talk about shopping. Talk about something which will interest the person. It can be cricket. It can be cooking. Some something which will be a point of interest. Pick it up from there. Make the counseling session as natural and as practical as possible. Sometimes at the end of the counseling session, you may feel, I have not achieved anything today. I have not done anything today. But a big stage of rapport has been built. So don't think it is a waste of time. And encourage verbal expression. Help the person to talk to them because you tell them that I understand your feelings. Sometimes they say, I'm very angry. I don't want to talk to you. It's okay. I understand that you're angry. It's all right that you're angry. You have the right to be angry. And just be quiet. As counselors, there is one mistake which we do. That mistake is most of the time, we have a temptation to keep talking. Try to do very little talking. Let the counselee do all the talking. You talk very little. Summarize very little, reflect back very little, very, very little. Sometimes as counselors, we feel, what if the counselee thinks I don't know anything? That's why I'm not talking. Don't be comfortable. Be comfortable with the silence there. Just be quiet and let them talk. Sometimes you have to be learning to be quiet in the silence. Just understand their feelings. The other thing is, when you listen to them, when you talk to them verbally, when you help them to express themselves verbally, you have to be aware of your own feelings as a counselor also. Because sometimes your patience itself is being tested. Because usually a depressed brain will be a complainer. It will be an anxious brain. Usually they keep on complaining. They are always negative. And sometimes as counselors, we feel very irritated. But that there's so many good things in the world. Why is this person complaining? Why is this person irritable? Why is this person negative about everything? So be aware of your own feelings. Don't get impatient because we are talking to somebody, we are listening to somebody who is deeply broken and shattered inside. So don't encourage dependence. Don't encourage dependence also because as counselors, we feel very good when somebody is depending on us, when we feel powerful, when somebody says, you are the only hope for me, auntie. You are the only hope for me. So we feel very good. That is not a healthy relationship between a counselor and a counselee. So don't encourage dependence and let us be aware that we don't enjoy that feelings of power and importance. Okay, the other thing when you talk to depressed people, deal with the physiology. Deal with the physiology. We are only talking about psychotherapy and counseling skills for the addicts and depressed. So I'm focusing only on that today. Deal with the physiology. What is physiology? It is the physical reasons, biological reasons which have probably caused the depression. It can be nutrition. So teach them to have a balanced diet. Teach them to have pulses, fruits, vegetables, protein, carbohydrate. Everything has to be a little balanced. So their eating habits has to be altered. Sleep has to be altered. Exercise has to be regularized. And they have to be referred to a psychiatrist to rule in or rule out organicity. What is organicity? Just to rule in or rule out any physical cause for depression. If you feel this person is too much for you, if you feel this person is not improving, I will suggest that you refer this person to somebody who is more professional or somebody who is a more trained person than you. Okay. The next thing is deal with the causes. In the previous episode, we talked about what are all the etiological factors, what are all the causal factors for depression and addiction. Now, as we talk about psychotherapy, as we talk about counseling, take all those causes and deal with one cause at a time. Find out if it is a psychological cause or a physical cause. Find out if it is a background related, family related, peer group related, or it is a temperament related, or is it a personality related? What is it? Then you have to find out what related cause it is. See if it is a past influence. See if the depression has happened because of a family pressure. You have to challenge the right perspective. Why don't you try to look at life through a different way? So that is how you deal with the cause. Because a person with depression has always seen the problem from a negative perspective. So you have to take them, you have to work with them and show them that they have to look at life through a positive perspective, wear a different set of glasses, involve the family if needed, teach them how to form relationships. And also when you deal with causes, you have to encourage action in the place of inactivity, which means most depressed people will sleep for a long time, or they'll sit like a couch potato in front of the TV. They'll just sit. Very poor hygiene, very poor self-care skills, adaptive skills are very poor, and they will not be able to take care of themselves and push them into action on their own. So you give them, like I told you for the addicts, this gets overlapped here again, give them a very short schedule. Don't give them 10 things to do for a day. Just give them 4 or 5 things to do. Once they have started achieving that, give them one more area which they can introduce and start action. Let them play, let them talk, let them laugh, let them listen to something, some comedy, let them listen to their favorite music. And we've talked enough about stress. When we talk about stress, stress also is something which will be resolved when there is cognitive acceptance of the problem. Yes, there is a problem. These are all the ways I can handle my problem. I have not handled it because I have practiced something called learned helplessness. I am not able to control my situation. I am not able to do anything about my situation. So I have learned to live with my problem. That is not how we have to accept our problem. That causes a lot of stress. I am not able to do anything. But when you sit with a counselor, you can definitely chalk out areas where we need to work. And we also have to understand that we don't have to understand everything. That itself will bring down a lot of stress. We have to understand we don't have to please everybody. We don't have to be accepted by everybody. That itself will bring a lot of stress. Bring down a lot of stress. Planning life. Planning finances. Planning the family. Planning work. Sometimes children before and after NEET, they commit suicide because of stress. Why? Because they have not been studying through the year. Exam stress is there because a lot of holding of subjects, lot of studying, lot of late night sitting only during exams. That is why the stress is there. So children ought to also have to be taught what planning is so that they will learn to handle stress. Then we talked about something called learned helplessness. Now this learned helplessness is something where we learn to accept uncontrollable events. Now we need to understand certain things in life we can control. Certain things we cannot control. We cannot try to control situations which are beyond our control. When we try to do that, stress increases. There may be anger. Anger has to be dealt. That is definitely a cause of depression when it is internalized, when it is not vented, when it is not resolved. So encourage the person to talk about your anger. That is very important. Encourage the person to deal with the guilt. Let them demark, is this real guilt or is this false guilt? If it is false guilt, then I will not have to work on it. If it is real guilt, I will resolve it with God and man. So bring a lot of insight and teach them something called confession and teach them forgiveness and help them to walk through that road to recovery and forgiveness. Another important thing for people with depression is deal with their thinking, deal with their cognitive, because usually their thinking is very negative, purposeless, meaningless. You have to show them life has lot of options. They have lot of potentials. They have lot of skills in them. So the entire thinking process itself has to be challenged. They have to learn to be looking at life through a different angle, looking at life through different perspectives, because your thinking will change your feelings. The way we think, our thoughts can definitely have an influence over our feelings. So help them to have a thought diary, which will help them to record all the negative thoughts that they have. Then when they come to you for counseling, take one thought at a time, challenge it gently, show them what the word of the Lord shows about that thought, and replace that negative thought with a positive thought, and that is very important. Okay, and then we deal with inactivity that we already talked about. Take them for a vacation, take them for family picnics, then give them a daily routine, and that will usually give them a lot of optimism and positivity. When you encourage activity, especially for depressed people, start with activities which will give them success so that they feel, wow, I was able to do this. I was able to achieve this. I was able to be successful in doing this. There are some people who feel they cannot make a cup of coffee in the morning. There are some depressed people who come to me with like that. My mommy doesn't make me coffee. And this depressed person may be around 30 years old. So I tell them, you cannot make your own coffee. She says, no, I cannot. So for the next 3 weeks, coffee making will be the goal for that person. And then once the person starts making coffee, they feel very good. They come and tell me, I made my own coffee. I also made coffee for mommy today. Okay. So give them activities which are very, give them activities which will help them to have success, which will help them to feel that they were able to achieve, and give them ample compliments. Give them a lot of encouragements. Also deal with the environment. Deal with the environment. Sometimes in winter months, we saw earlier, when there is not enough sunlight, sunlight does not enter into the retina. That also gives less stimulation to the brain. That can also be a seasonal affective depression disorder. So be very careful. That can only be seasonal. Modify their routines, reduce their workloads, workloads, and give them periodic vacations. And find them groups which can be supportive without being judgmental. Okay, now before I finish, I have a very, very important thing to say. When we talk about addiction and when we talk about counseling the depressed, there is something which we need to deal with. We cannot evade this. This is the dealing with potential for self-harm. Potential for self-harm, which means talk about suicide. Talk about suicide. Many times we feel, how will I use the word? I don't want to use the word. I feel delicate as a counselor to use the word. Or maybe when I ask them, do you want to commit suicide? Have you been thinking about killing yourself? Have you been thinking about not extending your life? Have you been thinking about not wanting to live anymore? These are all some different words which we use for suicide. But then people feel, why should I prompt it to them? Why should I ask my counselor that? We should ask them, because suicide itself is a cry for attention for many people. We have to give them an open door. We have to tell them, even if you have been contemplating suicide, even if there have been suicidal ideations, even if you have had concrete suicidal plans, I am here for you to talk. I am here for you to listen to you. I can understand your pain. I can understand your feelings. So it is okay for you to feel suicidal. It's okay for you to feel suicidal. I hope you understand me clearly. Okay? So give them an open door. Give them a place where they can safely talk about that. So it is very important. Now, when you feel that there is a potential for self-harm, this is a time when you have to be alert not to make major changes in the person's life, like a change of job, like marriage, change of place, change of school. All these are some things which we need to be very, very careful at this time, because we have to consider the consequences. Now, when we talk about suicide, talking about suicide itself will help them to understand potential for self-harm. Help them to ventilate whatever frustrations have been there. How do you talk about suicide? You see, if there is an evidence of any kind of a realistic plan for suicide, see if there are very strong feelings of hopelessness, very strong feelings of meaninglessness, and very strong guilt. If it is there, you will know that the person at some point has probably thought about suicide. See if there have been any recent environmental stressors in the family or in the work spot or in school, okay? And maybe the person was not able to cope with stress properly, or there has been excessive concern about physical illness. Now, recently I heard that one VIP, a very important person, he just went for a corona test. He gave a swab, and even before the results came out, he went and committed suicide because he was not willing to face it. Maybe there is some kind of a threat towards the physical illness. What if I'm not able to go through this? What if my family is going to suffer because of my physical illness? Let me commit myself. Let me commit suicide and kill myself. Is there a preoccupation about insomnia? What is insomnia? I am not able to sleep. I am not able to adequate sleep. I am not able to have undisturbed sleep. If there is a undue preoccupation with insomnia, that also is a reason for thinking about suicide. Any evidence of disorientation. Sometimes there is a tendency for these people to be dependent and dissatisfied in the same time on the counselor. Suddenly, sometimes they feel very happy. Sometimes they feel very sad. If there is a sudden shift to the extremes of mania and depression, you need to be extremely alert. And one more set of people you need to be alert about suicide is if they have had failure of suicidal attempts in the past. I know of an uncle who had hung himself once and the rope broke. Second time he hung himself, he was not able to kill himself. The third time somebody saved him. The fourth time he did not try. Nobody took him for counseling. The fourth time he took an overdose of antidepressants. And he died. He killed himself. So when you know that there are repeated failure attempts of suicide, the person is at more risk of attempting suicide. Do not hesitate to ask. Do not hesitate to ask if they have been thinking about taking their lives or killing themselves, because that will only help them to delay the process. So you can have a contract. I will see you tomorrow. Every day evening at around 5 o'clock in the evening, you have to call me and talk to me. You have to make a video call to me. You can have some contracts. Next time when you come, do all this homework and come to me. So these are all some things which we can do as a contract to prevent suicide. But there's one thing as counselors and as Christians, as barefoot counselors, we need to remember: we cannot prevent suicide forever. We can protect the person. We can help the addicts, we can help the depressed, we can lead them, we can guide them, we can pray for them. But ultimately, at some point, if they commit suicide and kill themselves, the counselor or the counselor's family may not be responsible for that act. Okay, so this episode, we have talked about very brief psychotherapies of how you counsel a person with substance abuse addiction, how you counsel a person with a addictive behavior, and how you counsel the person with depression. If you have any questions, you can ask me. Thank you for listening.
Thank you, Vanjalinaka. It was a holistic session of mental health, physical health, social well-being, and spiritual needs. I request Rita Anjali to lead us in the closing prayer, and we can take questions after that. Ritajli, can you pray?
Yes, I'll pray. Thank you, Lord, for this wonderful time that you have given us, Father. We had a wonderful learning session of psychotherapy techniques. We give you all the glory and praise, Lord. Lord, help us to implement this learning in our daily lives. Help us to be aware of people around us and be sensitive to them who needs help. Lord, thank you that you are there, and in you we have victory. In you we will be able to understand and bring that person out from their physical and mental state, Lord Father. Thank you for being with us, and in Jesus' most precious name I ask this prayer. Amen.